So what I want to do is to just finish with what we started yesterday about the ABC model, and then wrap this thing up, and then go to talk a little bit about anomalous heat conduction in some systems. Okay, so that's what I want to do. Okay, so this is the model, just very briefly. Lattice, three kinds of particles, ABC, with the rates given there. And we have argued last time that you start with some random configuration, eventually it should phase separate. And basically it's a very strong phase separation. That is, namely, that configurations, the steady state configurations are, you know, A's, B's, and C's with some mixture at the boundary, a little bit at the boundary, but otherwise it's almost pure phases A, B, and C. And also that this phase separation takes place for any Q not equal to 1, which is basically hard to get rid of it. It's any Q which is not equal to 1, they will phase separate. Okay? We did it for Q less than 1. Of course, Q larger than 1, it's just renaming things. Instead of A, B, and C, it will be A, C, and B. So there's some symmetry. So there is no problem. Okay? Okay. Then we started talking about a special case where the three densities are equal. The three average densities are equal, so the number of A's, B's, and C's are equal. And they say that for this case, and only for this case, one can define these dynamics obey some detailed balance with respect to some energy or Hamiltonian. And I want to construct this Hamiltonian. Okay, and that's what we started to do last time. And remember, it has a detailed balance for any Q, although the rates are not symmetric. That is, it moves in one direction and the other with the different rates. It's as long as the three densities are equal, it's the steady state obeys detailed balance with respect to some Hamiltonian. Now, it turns out that this Hamiltonian has long-range interactions, and that's what makes it interesting. Okay, so we started constructing the energy. We say that the probability of finding a microscopic... where is the pointer? There was some heavy points. There was, yeah, there was a big one. Okay. Ah, it's there. Okay. Ah. Okay. This can use. Okay, so the probability of finding a state, a microscopic configuration X, is Q to the power E, and E is some function of the configurations. And then we started constructing this E, okay? And we say the following. You start with a configuration where all are phase separated, A, B's, and C's, and now we start permuting, okay? We give this configuration, this would be so-called the ground state, has zero energy, and by permuting AB into BA, we get a new configuration, and we assign it an energy, which is E plus 1. And if we go backward, we assign it an energy, we reduce the E by 1, and similarly for BC and CA, etc. Because AB, AC, and CA, they like to be in this order and not the reverse, and therefore, reversing the order would cost energy, and therefore that's how we increase it. And it's easy to see that with respect to the dynamics that I defined, this assignment of energy would give obeys detailed balance with respect to this measure, which is Q to the power E of X. Okay? Because that's, you can easily check that the detailed balance is satisfied for any move. Okay, now the question you can ask, okay, we defined this energy in a very strange way. You just I said, in order to find an energy with a given configuration, I should start with a phase-separated state and then make permutation, reach that state, and calculate the energy. Now, what guarantees that if I go in different routes, I'll get the same energy? Okay, so that's in order to have a single-valued function energy, you need to make sure that this happens. Okay, now for this to happen, that's where this condition that the three densities have to be equal enter. And it's only for this case that you have this, you satisfy this condition that going, you know, to from one state to another, the assigned energy would be independent of how you get there. Okay? And the way to see it is very simple. Take a state, you know, this one, and now take this A at the left and bring it all the way, make permutations, and bring it all the way to the right. Okay? Now the question is, clearly, these two states have to have the same energy because it's periodic boundary condition and nothing really happens. I just shifted by one. Okay? Now what is the energy of this state? The energy of this state, you see, when I permute this A with the B's, each time I do it, I increase the energy by one. So I do it NB times, so the energy increases by NB. And then when it moves through the C's, each time I permute it, the energy decreases by one. And therefore, the end energy is just E plus NB minus NC, and therefore it has to be equal to E, and therefore it works only for the case where the three densities are equal, okay? So we have a well-defined energy, and the question is, what do we do with it? Okay, turns out that you can express this energy in the following form. Okay, now I want to write it in as a formula, okay? And the energy can be expressed in the following way, and this shows that, in fact, the interaction in this energy is long-ranged. It's not local. Although, remember, the important thing is that the dynamics is local. The moves do not depend on whatever the rest of the system is doing. It just depends on the local environment. On the other hand, the energy turns out to be non-local. And the way to express it in this way is the following. Take this ring and just cut it. And assign it, just put it on a line from 1 to n. And now, the energy can be written in the following way. Ci is an operator, which it is 1 if on site I there is a C, and it's 0 otherwise. Okay, similarly for A and for B. So, each time, so now we think about this open line. Ci bi plus 1 means that if on site I there is a C, and on site B I plus K somewhere here, there is a B, that would add 1 to the energy, okay? But it's only when the B is to the right of the A, okay? Similarly, the A and the C, and similarly for the C and the A, and you count all the pairs where the B is to the left of the C is to left of the A, and the A is to left of the B, and that gives you a number. And it turns out, not to go into it, you can show that this expression gives you the same energy that I defined before. If you just do the permutations, you'll get the same energy. Now, okay, first of all, first thing you'll note that this is energy, the way it is expressed is not manifestly translational invariant because I cut it in some place and, you know, I cannot shift it. You can turn it into a translationally invariant form by, you know, cutting it in different places, in all places, and adding them up. They should give you the same energy. You end up with this energy, which is expressed on a ring. Now it's on a ring. So again, you have this coefficient, but the coefficient is now going to be 1 minus I k over n. Okay? If the distance between the, say, the I and the B is k, this is the energy, and now you do it on a ring, okay? So that's how you do it. So it is translationally invariant, there is no problem. The second thing to note is that this energy is long-ranged. It's not local. That is, the energy, this site, Ci, interacts with all the Bs to the left of it. If I use this expression, the above expression. So, and it interacts with it, with the Bs, with the same strength. So therefore, it's very non-local. Okay? And basically, that's how, so we know what is the steady state of the system. We know it's phase separated. And this comes very naturally from the fact that you have long-range interaction in this system, because that's the only way you can have long-range order in one-dimensional system, if you have the energy. Okay? So indeed, this driven system that we started with, this ABC model, which typically does not obey detailed balance. It does not obey detailed balance for any Q and for any N, which are, does not satisfy this. It has this, when you can write its steady state in terms of some energy, this energy is long-ranged. Okay? But of course, when the densities are not equal, you still can write down, in principle, large deviations function, which should be kind of long-ranged, because we know that it phase separates even when the three densities are not equal, as long as all three densities are not zero. Okay, that's important. By the way, I was asked last time, why do I do it with three species, why not two? With two, it doesn't work, because if you have only A's and B's, then suppose you try to phase separate the A's and the B's, and of course, because of boundary conditions, you are having, it's a ring, you have something like that, then clearly this AB is a happy boundary. This A does not cross the B, does not move into the B. On the other hand, this boundary is unstable because this B would start propagating into the A. And therefore, basically, this domain will melt through the right side of it. So it's only when you have at least three kinds that you can have this phase separation. You don't really need to have three species. You can do with two. But you need next nearest neighbor interaction. You need to define at least three kinds of domain walls. So it's not. You can do it with two species, but you need some interaction to do that. So that's not a problem. Okay. So that's what I wanted to say. Okay, so just a summary that you have, this is for this three, when the densities are equal, this is the steady state, the energy could be expressed either this way or that way, and the point to note is that the dynamics is local, but there is long-range order for any Q not equal to one. And we have demonstrated it only for equal densities, but it's true for any other density. You can calculate, by the way, the partition sum of this mode. Yeah.
When you say it's true, it's...
I think the argument is very robust. There's no doubt about it. Proving it is a different story. It's very robust. You can calculate things in the weak. In the weak asymmetry limit, when Q goes to one, I'll talk about it in a minute. But yeah.
I have also another question. The convergence to the stationary state is extremely slow.
Very slow. In fact, it's very slow. You see, if you start with infinite system, it never reaches. It's a coarsening process. Like, with the Ising model, even with any model which has a conserved quantity, that you want to have phase separation. Because of the conservation, it will go very slowly. Typically, in phase separation, it goes like some power law of T or something. Here, it goes very slowly. If you look at the typical size, you know, you start with some random configuration, the system will very quickly form little domains. Now, these domains will grow in time, and they have a typical size, call it L, okay? So this L will grow logarithmically with T. So it's a very slow process, because it has to come a barrier, overcome a barrier in order to do that.
But even if you start that you're already phase separated in three blocks, you have to wait that it averages over all the positions, and that will be exponential anyway.
Yeah.
The blocks have to rotate.
Right, and that's why it's logarithmic. That's why it's logarithmic in time. Yeah. But it keeps evolving as usual in phase separation. States when you have conserved quantities. Okay, partition sum. I think that's a very nice exercise. You can calculate the free energy of this model again for the three equal densities, and that's a very nice, very simple exercise. So to do that, I just want to show it because it's nice. Not that it. Suppose you start with a single boundary. So you have only A's, and it's very long, and then you have the B's. I just take one boundary. And I want, and as I said, when I forget the other thing, because the probability of this A getting to the C is very small, forget it. Now I want to basically do low temperature expansion, that is, look at the excitations. Okay, how they are of a single boundary. Okay, of a single boundary. Okay, so that's what I want to do, and so I call it the partition sum would be Z1 of Q, and Z1 is basically is the following. The energy here is integer, right? It's just some number. The energies are as we define them, right, from the permutation. So a state with energy n, it has a weight q to the n, right? Okay, little n. And the question is how many microscopic states do I have with energy n? Okay, that's what you have to count. This is p of n. You take the sum, this will give you the basically the partition sum, and then you have to make sure that you have three domains like that, and okay, and but that's not a problem. So let's calculate just the partition sum of a single domain wall, okay? That's okay. So what are the so Pn is the degeneracy of excitations of energy n. So what is energy n? Suppose we start with energy zero. Energy zero, we have I'll turn on the light. Okay, there is one state. This is the state, right? This one has energy zero. So P of zero is one. How about P of one? P of one, again, is very simple. I just make one permutation, right? So P of one is also one. How about two? Now, to get energy two, you can do it in two ways. Either you take this A and you make two permutations into the B, or you can take this A, make one permutation into the B, and then take this A and make another permutation into the B, okay? So it's basically two states, but which are either two or one plus one, okay? Now you can continue with this exercise. There is either you go with a single A, go three steps, or one of them go two steps and the other one is one, or one plus one plus one, etc. So basically these are, so you have three states, P of four is five, and then starts increasing. So what is Pn? Pn is basically the number of partitions of integer n. If you have n, an integer, you ask how many ways you have to write it as sum of integers. Okay, so that's the partition, a number of partition problem. And that's a well-studied problem, well known. Asymptotically, when n goes to infinity, it goes like e to the power square root of n with some coefficients. A lot of great mathematicians have worked on it, etc. So this enters into the partition sum of this model. P of n, okay, does not have simple expression. But on the other hand, the partition sum itself has a very simple expression. It just, z1 is just 1 over 1 minus q, 1 minus q squared, 1 minus q cubed. It's just the Euler function. This is the Euler function. It's just this product. And it's 1 over the Euler function. That's the partition sum. And from which, so basically that gives you the partition sum. You take the log, you get the free energy. The partition sum of the full model, you have to take it cubed because you have three domains. So it's a cubed. And the ground state is degenerate n times because I can start with rotated, so there's another factor of n. But basically, you can calculate the free energy and, okay. And you can prove phase separation using this kind of, you know, starting from these considerations. That's, okay, I don't want to get into it. Okay? Yes?
But for the three
species,
is that an asymptotic result in n? Because I think finite n, that the counting, you have some overlapping.
No, no, okay. Up to some exponential in n, it's okay because okay. I ignore configurations where the a goes through the b's and into the goes throughout the b's and reach the c's, you know, the other domain. So I'm assuming that the three domains are separated, and the separation is e to the n, so that's no problem. It's exponentially small in n. Okay. Okay, that's, I don't want to say that. One other comment I want to make before quitting this problem is a weakly asymmetric ABC model. That's an interesting issue, which again has been considered quite extensively. The problem is the following. In the ABC model, as I defined it, it's always phase separated for any q not equal to 1. Now, so when q goes to 1, you expect, you know, at q equals 1, it's homogeneous, right? But for any q not equal to 1, it's phase separated. So can I define a q that goes into 1? You know, I want to vary in q. I want to vary q with n so that I can get a phase transition, depending on how I go to q equals 1, okay? So this is the problem. Q equals 1 is homogeneous. Q less than 1 is phase separated. So let's consider Q, which depends on n. So Q, I take Q to be e to the minus beta over n. Beta is some parameter, okay? So to leading order, it's 1 minus beta over n. So it's very close to 1. And as I increase n, I also, Q goes towards 1. And the question is whether I go from the phase-separated side or from the homogeneous side. Okay, that's the issue. So one can show, I will not demonstrate it here, one can write down hydrodynamic equations for this. One can show that in fact there is a critical value of beta, which it turns out for the three equal densities is equal to this value. And if beta is smaller than that value, you will approach the homogeneous state. And if beta is larger than that, then this critical value, you'll go into phase-separated state. So that's a low temperature and high temperature. Beta is 1 over temperature, and basically. And you get phase separation at low temperature. Of course, if you take other powers, not beta over n, but beta over n squared or n cubed, clearly, if you take power which is smaller than 1, say 1 over e to the minus beta over square root of n, it will always be phase separated. And if you take 1 minus beta over n squared, it will always be homogeneous. So the borderline is this value, is this beta critical over n. Whatever decays faster is on one side, whatever decays slower is on the other side. So this is noted by these people here, and okay. And last comment I want to make in this respect is: what does it mean that you take Q, which goes like e to the minus beta over n, in terms of the energy that we defined before. Okay, at least this is for, you can do it again for any ratio of Na, Nb, and Nc. This particular value of beta critical is for the equal densities. Now, in terms of energy, remember, the steady state is such that that the weight of, okay, that probability of a state x is q to the power e, right, of x. That's how we define it. Now, if q is beta over n, it means that you rescale the energy by 1 over n. Okay? So the effective, it's as if, you know, we can do the same exercise we did before for the equal density case. But the energy now will be 1 over n of the energy that we had before. And such an energy can support phase transition. The reason is the following. If you don't have the 1 over n, this energy is very high. It's of order n squared. Okay? By rescaling it by 1 over n, you bring the energy down to order n, and then you can have a competition between entropy and energy, and that's how you get a phase transition. So it was the energy was not extensive in the original setting, and therefore it just determines everything. The entropy doesn't have any role to play, and you get, it's always ordered, the energy wins. But when you rescale the energy by 1 over n, then the energy becomes of order n, and you can have a phase transition, and that's what happens. This is like, you know, when you do any mean field calculation, where all particles interact with all other particles, you have to rescale it by 1 over n to make it extensive. Okay? Questions so far? Basically, that's what I wanted to say about this model. There are plenty of other, you know, you can take it in many directions. You can consider perturbations which do not conserve particles, that is, particles can evaporate and condense. You can do all kinds of other things, and there are many interesting phenomena that appears there. For example, since you have long-range interactions in these systems, effectively, you know, in this way, ensembles become non-equivalent, and there are all kinds of effects that you can discuss. Okay, but this is just a very simple way of how spontaneous symmetry breaking can take place in this very simple driven model. Okay, yeah, questions? Okay, so I want at this point to move to a different the last sub. What's going on? Ah. That's it. Where is it? Just 1 second. Okay. So I want to move to the last subject of this talk, which is anomalous heat conduction. I'll give some introduction, but at the end I will talk about a work which was done together with Julien Cividini from, he was over at Say, he's currently a postdoc at Weizmann, Anupam Kundu, and Asaf Miron, who is a master student at Weizmann. Okay, what is the issue? The issue is the following. We talk about heat transport. So we have a system, doesn't matter what, which is placed in between two reservoirs, T plus on the left and T minus on the right. and we generate a current and heat current. And the heat current, typically what one expects is to obey the Fourier law, which means that the current, the energy current, is proportional to delta T, the temperature difference, divided by N. N is the length of the system. And kappa is the conductivity, the heat conductivity. And kappa is some number, okay? Finite number. This is, of course, in diffusive systems, this happens very naturally. The energy is just the gradient of the current, and the current is the gradient of temperature, and then how that's how you get that in the steady state, delta T, the Laplacian of T is zero in a steady state, and therefore it comes with a linear profile, right, in one dimension. Okay, it turns out that in many 1D systems and in some 2D systems, there is anomalous heat conduction. And this problem has been extensively studied in the last, 30 years or even more. And there are many names that associated with this program made beautiful progress in recent years. I'm not going to mention names because it's really a very long list and very, which have done very interesting contribution, very important contributions in this field. But let me just summarize what are the main things, just very briefly. Okay, in systems which have anomalous heat conduction, the current does not go like delta T over N, but it goes like a smaller power of N. So it's a huge current, relative, of course, to the normal one. So it goes like delta T over N to the power 1 minus alpha, with alpha is some parameter between 1 and 0. Okay? So that's one thing. The other observation is that if you look at this system develop long-range correlations, time correlations, in what's known as the total current. What's the total current? Take J of X and T is the local current at point X and time T. It's a fluctuating quantity. Now you sum over X, okay? So it's you sum over X. That's called the total current. Now if you look at the time correlation function of the total current, zero and time T, now this we have to divide by N because these are some this is in equilibrium, by the way. I'm looking at this in equilibrium. So there's no the average current is zero. So when you look at this correlation function in equilibrium, it decays with time very slowly, with some power law of time. And the decay goes like t to the power minus 1 with minus delta. It's power which is smaller than 1. Delta is some number between 0 and 1. Okay, so that's the total current. Okay, so there are some, in equilibrium, this system shows some very considerable correlations between the fluctuating currents in different places. Okay? Another property which usually comes with this anomalous heat conduction is that they have non-trivial temperature profile. Okay, we saw that in diffusive systems, the temperature profile is boring. It's just linear, right? Because delta squared of T is zero, and you get a line with some slope. Yes? Sorry?
There's a temperature difference between
two. Yeah. No, that's not. No, what I was saying, this correlation function in equilibrium decays like T to the minus. There's no temperature difference in equilibrium. Okay? Now I'm talking about temperature profile, but of course, where the two temperatures are different. Am I with you or?
No.
No. I'm calculating, take this system that when you put temperature a gradient, it shows a current of this form, okay? Now, put it the same temperature, the two bars are the same temperature. And you ask, what is the correlation between the current correlation in equilibrium? And this decays with time like that. So it's the same system, but equal temperature. I can put it different temperature, equal temperature, whatever.
How can we understand that delta is bounded below by zero?
You want it. Yeah. Otherwise, it will. You want it to go like. You want it to be negative.
So that it decays even faster.
Typically, it decays. Yeah, if it, maybe the point is it has to be less than one. But it has to be larger than zero because if it's negative, at least T2 minus squared could be, then, if it's below zero, then you get a normal conductivity. If you want to get anomalous.
So somehow there is a map from alpha, the parameter alpha,
right.
To delta.
Alpha equals delta, basically. The heat conduction is basically the integral of this correlation function, the heat conductivity. Right? So if this integral converges, then you get finite conductivity and everything is okay. So therefore, if delta is less than zero, it converges and everything is okay. Okay, so to be anomalous, that. And when it is one, you see this power is zero, then it cannot really go above one. Okay. Okay. Now, how about the temperature profile? And I will, my aim in this talk is basically to talk about temperature profile. Now, the temperature profile is not trivial. It's not a line, it's not linear, but it takes this form. And schematically, it goes of this form. And the temperature gradient, this is the temperature versus x, the gradient of this temperature profile diverges at the boundaries. Okay? There is an exponent nu, it's called the meniscus exponent, that with which it diverges. Now this happens for any delta t. That is, you can take delta t very small as you want, and still you will never reach to the linear, you'll never reach the linear profile that takes place in normal heat conduction. You always have, no matter how small delta t, you have this divergence of the temperature profile near the boundary. Okay? So now this kind of phenomena, these properties that I listed, that is large conductivity, very slow decay of current-current correlations in equilibrium, and non-trivial diverging, non-trivial with singularities of temperature profile, they characterize a set of models where basically in which you have modes of transport of energy which is faster than diffusive. If it's diffusive, then you get the Fourier law and everything is okay. But if you have, for some reason, a transport mechanism which is faster than diffusive, then you can get this kind of thing. And we'll talk about it in a minute. Okay. Just one interesting thing is a paper that appeared in 2000 by these people, Bonetto, Joel Lebowitz, and Ray Bellet. And they said, they summarized the state of art in this field then, and they say it's a challenge to theorists. And they discuss what are the open problems, and then they say the following. This is what we would consider a satisfactory answer to the challenge of the title of the article, and we offer a bottle of very good wine to anyone who provides it. Okay, and the challenge is to really write down a microscopic model, and with you know, some Hamiltonian, some interaction, couple it to a bath, and demonstrate that it has this anomalous behavior. It's done in all kinds of approximations. There was beautiful progress in this field in recent years by a group around Spohn and other people. And they asked Joel Lebowitz recently, how about his good bottle of wine? He says, no, it's still not there. So we'll have to wait. So maybe it's a challenge to people here to look into the problem. Okay. So, okay, what are the typical models? Here are some typical models. For example, you take a chain of coupled oscillators. So you take a chain of coupled oscillators with some nearest neighbor interaction, and the interaction is a function of qi, you know, of the difference between the coordinates, qi plus 1 minus qi. That is, these models have to be translationally invariant. That is, if these oscillators are not pinned to some substrate or whatever, it's just freely moving, and therefore there is a translation invariance. And the potential is nonlinear. Okay, there is a linear part, you know, that's harmonic, and then there are some nonlinear parts to it. Now, just note that the harmonic case is, that is, if you don't have nonlinearity, the problem is a bit trivial because not really trivial, but it's what happens is that whatever energy you introduce from one side, since it does not interact with the energy that comes from the other side, because the modes don't talk to each other, right? I mean, you have this Fourier modes of the harmonic crystal. So you have sound waves which are moving, and they don't talk to each other. They are not coupled. So if you introduce a lot of energy on one side, they will just the energy will propagate without really talking or without interacting with the other modes, and it will dump itself on the other side. So in this case, basically, the current goes like delta t, not delta t over n. So it's extremely anomalous, but in a trivial way that, no scattering. Okay, so that's one. A different class of models is that of hard disks. Okay, you have hard disks. Typically, the model that people study is a system of hard disks with alternating mass. So you have heavy, light particles, and they just collide with each other, and at the end they couple to some reservoir. Why do you need the alternating mass? If you take the same, if it's the same mass, then there is no energy transfer, because when two particles collide, they just exchange momenta. So it's as if nothing happens with elastic collision. So it's as if they just passed each other, nothing happened. So if you want to mix the momenta that are coming from the two particles, you need the two masses to be different from each other. So that's another model. And then there are stochastic models. For example, you can take particles, hard disks, same mass, when you have two particle collision, of course this doesn't do the job, but you have to consider three particle collision. That is, whenever three particles get close together, you mix their momenta in some way so that you conserve both energy and momentum. Okay, this is the name of the game. You have to conserve energy and momentum, and the way this is typically done is, you have to conserve the three particles which collide. You have to conserve the sum of pi's and the sum of pi squared, which is basically you take a sphere, which is the sum of pi squared is constant. That's the energy. You cut it with a plane, which is defined by the momenta, and you get a ring. And basically, whenever three particles come in, you pick up a point on that ring, and you assign the three momenta to be according to that. So basically, that's the rule. You do that, and And then you couple the system to two reservoirs, ask what happens then. So that's another. Here's another model. Here's it's a stochastic model. It's not Hamiltonian because it's collisions are stochastic. Okay, you don't. Okay, good. Okay, to study this model, there are two kinds of approaches. So very broad, you know, there are many ways, but one is non-equilibrium setting. That is, put temperature gradient and ask what is the current. That's very difficult, and there are very few models that you can really analyze this way because it's a non-equilibrium setting. You have to know what is the steady state of a non-equilibrium system. Okay, that's a tough problem. Except of some either numerics or some very some models that you can analyze, that it's very hard to do. The other approach is equilibrium. That is what you do is the following: you use linear response theory. That is, you express the conductivity as some express it in terms of some correlation function in equilibrium. Okay, so that's for your question. Okay, so you do basically use linear response and apply the Green-Kubo formula in equilibrium to get the conductivity. And the expression for the conductivity, this is kappa, the conductivity, it's the coefficient of delta T over N. Okay, this is the following. It's basically the integral. Okay, you take J of X and T. J is the local fluctuating current at X and time T. And J of at point Y time T. And take the average of that in equilibrium. Okay, equilibrium. And then you integrate over X, Y, and T. You do that, divide by T squared, whatever, that and in the limit of large N and large time tau, you integrate, this would give you the heat conductivity, the transport coefficient. That's the usual Green-Kubo formula for heat conduction. Okay? So basically, you have to analyze what is the fluctuation, the nature of the fluctuations in equilibrium, and that would give you the conductivity. And the conductivity, I can, you know, if you just integrate over X and over Y, the integral over X is what I call the total current at time T, while this will, the integral over Y will give you the total current at time zero, and the correlation function of the total current over time gives the transport coefficient, the heat conduction. Okay, so that's what you have to do, and then you can write down all kinds of approaches to analyze equilibrium fluctuations, and therefore that's a kind of richer approach to look into the problem. Okay. Now, coming back to the question that was before, kappa is the heat conduction is this, and if indeed it goes like the correlation function decays in time like t to the power minus 1 minus lambda, if you integrate it, if you integrate it, if delta is between 1 and 0, this integral diverges, right? So the way people deal with this is they say the following. You know, in these systems, there is a conservation of momentum, energy, and density, right? These are the models that we talk about. Now, clearly, when you have a system like that, there is sound modes, right? And they propagate with some finite velocities, the sound, sound velocity, okay? So clearly, if I make a perturbation in this system at some point, and I wait until this sound wave left the system, then after that there is no correlation because they correlate, the momenta are correlated as long as the sound wave is there, because the sound wave that I started here and it reached here, so clearly there is a correlation between this point and that point. This point knows after some time that what was the current here. But once it leaves the system, no correlation anymore. So people said, okay, let's integrate it, but not until time infinity, but rather stop at time n over c. C is sound's speed. And when you do, basically after that, there is no correlation. And then you get a kappa which goes like n to the power delta, which means that alpha and delta are the same thing, okay? Basically, that kappa gives it's as if it diverges with the system size. Okay,
so that's
okay. Okay, calculating temperature profile, and I'm what I want to do is to consider a model in which we want to calculate the temperature profile, particularly look at the singularities at the end and what we can say about the way it goes. Okay, to calculate the temperature profile, again we can use linear response theory. And the temperature, okay, and the way it goes is the following. You have a temperature, the two temperatures at the two ends, and there is a temperature profile which is stationary in the steady state, okay? So there is a temperature T of y. And there is the current at some point x, the steady state current at some point x. I can relate it by linear response. That is, at some point y, I make a perturbation dt dy. I make a little gradient of the temperature. That's the perturbation. And there is a kernel k of x and y that tells me a little perturbation of the temperature profile on point y. How does it affect the current at time x in the steady state? Now, clearly, j of x in the steady state is independent of x. It's a constant, right? Because that's a steady state. It's a one-dimensional system. In the steady state, the current is the same everywhere. So so this is a constant. And the kernel that couples, that tells you what's the response of point x to a perturbation at point y, it can be expressed in terms of the current-current correlation, the local current correlation function in equilibrium. That's the way to. So basically, that's linear response in this case. And I just want to stress that in order to calculate it here, this kernel, you have to take, you know, you have to work with finite system, and you have to be very careful with the boundary conditions at the two ends. You have to take the boundary conditions into account in a proper way. So that's how it's done. Okay? Okay. Okay, so let me just say how is it used. Clearly, if you want kappa, okay, if you have a diffusive system. In a diffusive system, dt dy is a constant. So the j is just dt dy times the integral over the kernel, right? And the integral over the kernel is finite, is some number in a normal conducting state. So in an anomalous state, this integral has to diverge. Otherwise it will not do. So basically, you want this integral of k of x and y, dy has to diverge. So that's why, typically, that's what happens, in fact, that k of y is going to look like some power law of x minus y. And the power law is such that the integral of it diverges, and therefore it goes like at large n, and that's why when alpha is less than 1, it diverges, and okay. So basically, suppose this indeed is the kernel. Just put an ansatz. This is the kernel. Then the j is just the integral over the kernel times dt dy, dy. Okay, that's the j, and j is a constant. Okay, is a constant. So you get an equation from here, since this is a constant. and this has to be a constant independent of x, that gives an equation for the temperature profile. In fact, this particular kernel, this particular equation can be inverted. There is this Sonnen inversion formula that, okay, not yet. Okay, that's what's written here. This is just rescaled n into y. You can invert the kernel. You see, you have to take this equation where j of u is constant, and you can invert it. And when you invert it, it turns out that dt dy, dv, is just given by this formula. It's v times 1 minus v to the power minus alpha over 2. Alpha is the exponent that goes into this kernel. So you can find the, you can find from which, by integrating it, you can find the temperature profile. And clearly, when this is the solution, clearly the meniscus exponents, the way dt dx diverges at the boundary, goes like nu to the power minus alpha over 2. So you get the way the temperature profile diverges. Yes?
So you
mean
that the kernel was chosen?
Yes. At this point, yes. Just by hand. It has to diverge the integral of it. So it has to be some power law. It cannot decay exponentially. But okay. But one has to calculate the kernel. You know, if you want to get it to a model, you have to calculate it. It turns out that in models where one can calculate it, it looks like that with some power law. Okay. But I'll get to it. Okay? Now, so this gives a relation between nu and alpha. Remember, nu is the way the temperature profile, the gradient, diverges at the boundary. And alpha is the exponent that determines the conductivity, right? It goes like n to the power, 1 over n to the power 1 minus alpha. Okay? And there is this relation. It turns out that this relation is not always correct. There are some problems in it. And the reason is that you have to take boundary conditions into account, and that's what I want to discuss a little bit. Okay. So now we reached where I want to start talking about a particular model, and I give you the results. I'm not sure I will be able to get into more details. But what I want to do is to consider a model. And I want to calculate current correlation functions, which can be done, and use it to obtain this kernel, calculate the kernel, and use it to calculate the temperature profile, which can be done. And what I want to show is that the temperature profile, that's the main point that I want you to get from this talk, depends on the actual coupling to the bath. You change the coupling to the bath a little bit, you get different temperature profile. Not only different temperature profile, but also the exponent that controls, you see, the temperature profile looks something like that. And it turns out that the exponent here, which is dt dx, goes like x to the power minus nu. This exponent depends on some coupling to the bath, which is just benign parameter, which is not. So it's not a universal thing. The alpha, the heat conduction, could be universal. But the profile itself, and particularly this kind of exponent, is not. And I want to show you how this exponent depends, give you a formula, on the coupling to the bath. And how the profile depends on. OK? So that's. OK? So that's. This is the point of the rest of the talk. So to now was some kind of introduction. And okay, what is the model? The model was introduced. Okay, let's talk about it. I want to take harmonic chain. So you have a chain, harmonic chain, with kinetic energy and some springs, which are harmonic. And then there is dynamics, which is the equations of motion. okay, and sites and particles, and they are coupled by springs. Now, I told you before that harmonic chains are really not really interesting because modes are not coupled. So you need to couple the modes in some way. And in order to couple the mode and still be able to solve the problem, you do the following thing. You introduce stochastic momentum exchange. That is, every now and then, with some rate, gamma, you take two nearest neighbor and you exchange their momenta. Okay? And then the chain evolves by its Hamiltonian dynamics, and every now and then you mix the momenta, and then basically. This model was introduced by people like Lepri, Monastery, I'll have the reference a little bit before. Other people worked on it, but this is the model I want to consider. Okay. Boundary terms. Okay. How does it couple to the... I have to tell you how it coupled to the heat bath, and this is the issue I want to consider, and it's the following. You take a P1. P1 is the end, this site, and you couple it to a bath. It's coupled only to site 2, okay? So that's the spring here. But you introduce some noise term, which has some, you know, thermal distribution. But in order to obey fluctuation dissipation, you have to introduce dissipation, dissipative term. So basically, you have a noise term psi 1, and then there is a dissipation term, lambda minus lambda p1, that's a dissipative. And the Gaussian is related, the width of the Gaussian is related to lambda, such that the width is 2 lambda times the temperature, right? That's the fluctuation dissipation, okay? So you have to always noise and dissipation. You introduce them together. And similarly, you do it on the other end. And the temperatures are different, you know, T plus and T minus on the side. Lambda is a free parameter. Lambda is a parameter that tells you how fast it interacts with the bath. That is, if lambda is very large, it means that energy is dissipated very quickly. Or it means that this particle at the end basically almost stands still, and therefore it's like fixed boundary condition. On the other hand, if lambda is very small, then the end particle can move free, you know, it takes it a long time, but in principle, they have the same temperature. The temperature does not depend on lambda. Lambda is a parameter, dynamical parameter. And what I want to show you is that this meniscus exponent and the profile depend on lambda, which is some dynamical parameter, which is nothing. Yeah?
But what if one bath is made of one material and the other of water, and lambda is on both sides, something different? And then this model would suggest that heat conductivity is somehow totally dependent on something else than...
Yeah, it could depend on many things. Yeah, it could depend on... you can consider different lambda on both sides. And the formula I'm going to give you is with lambda plus here and lambda minus there. Okay? Okay, as long as it, you know, the crucial thing is that it has a temperature T, you know, the right temperature that you want. That is, it's just the ratio between the noise strength and the dissipative term. Could be different, you're right. Okay, now I'm afraid it's going to be a little bit technical, but let's just go through it. So these are the equation of motion that you have to satisfy, ignoring for a minute, momentum exchange. I want to write them in terms of the difference, you know, the code, you know, the not qi, but in terms of s, which is the qi plus 1 minus qi. That's basically the length, the spring variable. So it looks like that. So the dsi, dpi, and p1 and pn, and okay, these are the equations. Now, we have these variables Si, Pi, and the energy of site I, which is the kinetic energy plus the potential energy that comes from the two springs that's attached to it. Okay? Now, you can look at this equation, write them in the continuum limit, and you see that ds dt is just dp dx, and dp dt is ds dx, and the ae is the energy dt is just the derivative of p times s dx. You know, just write it in a continuum limit, the usual equations here. So you want to write it in terms of normal modes. Okay, you have three conserved quantities, s, p, p, and e, and but they are coupled equations. You want to write them in normal modes. And the normal modes are, if you look, take phi plus, which is omega s minus p, phi minus is omega s plus p, and phi zero is e. These are the normal modes. One is sound wave moving to the right. Basically, it's x minus p, x plus p, and the energy. So you have a sound mode moving to the right, sound mode moving to the left, and an energy mode. Okay? And the equations, okay, ignoring the details, these are the equations in terms of the normal modes. So the sound modes, ddt, they have the ddx of plus or minus omega phi. That's the velocity to the right and velocity to the left of the modes. Okay, that's the sound velocity of the two modes. On the other hand, the energy mode is diffusive, so it doesn't have any velocity, and the leading term is second order, but it depends only on phi plus squared and minus phi minus squared. So basically the current, if you want, the energy current is related to phi plus squared minus phi minus squared. So these are the equations that you want to look into. Now, so far we ignored the momentum exchange. To take the momentum exchange into account, you have to, basically this is going to introduce some fluctuating hydrodynamics. That is, these are the hydrodynamic equations that we have here, but they are fluctuating hydrodynamics because you every now and then you exchange the momenta. And basically the equations are going now to look in the following way. There is a diffusion constant in the phis, which goes with phi plus minus. And then you have to add a noise that goes with it to obey fluctuation dissipation, and similarly for phi zero, okay? And the noise terms are uncorrelated, we assume they are uncorrelated, and this diffusion constant d and d zero basically come from the gamma. Okay, now what is the energy current? As I said, the energy current is phi plus squared minus phi minus squared, up to a constant. Okay, now come boundary conditions. So let me, if you want, okay. So basically, what we have to do is to solve for the sound mode terms with the proper boundary condition. And then we know what is the current of the local current of the energy. And that's what we want. We want the local current of the energy. So basically, we have to have a solution for the way the sound modes behave. Okay, what are the boundary terms? And for this case, we managed to find the boundary conditions, and it's in the following way. Look at this. These are the equations. I go back to the discrete case, and this is the equation for P1, okay? You see that the equation for P1, for the site 1, is different from the equation, from the equation in the bulk, okay? So I want to bring it to be the same form. I want to regularize the problem, that is, write it in the same form. So I introduce new variables, S0 and P0. I introduce another site, 0, and write dp1 dt is omega squared times S1 minus S0. I just introduced this S0, but then I have to add it to compensate for it. So basically, that's the equation. I just introduced a variable, and I demand that this thing is zero. So S0 satisfies this equation. So in this way, I have the equation for P1 to be the same form as the equation for the rest of the system. Now I want this to happen to take place at any time, not only at time equal to zero. So I can take the time derivative of this and demand that it's also equal to zero. You do it, and basically you, what you reach is that an equation like that, the second equation. So these are the two equations that guarantees that this S0, that I, that the last the term P1 and S1 behave like the bulk term that bulk size that we have. Okay, so so in terms of, so these are the two equations that we have to satisfy. I want to express them in terms of the normal mode, and basically, if you do that, yeah, just take this definition, introduce them here. What you find is that the boundary conditions are that phi plus minus r, phi minus at x equal to zero has to be zero, and also the derivative of x with respect to plus minus plus r times the derivative of phi minus at x equal to zero is equal to zero. That's the boundary conditions we have to satisfy. And r is just given by lambda minus omega divided by lambda plus omega. So basically that gives a whole set the equations that govern the behavior of the sound mode in this problem. Now, and of course similarly, we have another boundary condition on the other side. Now, what is this r? Okay, r is just, what is r? R, okay, phi plus minus r phi minus at the boundary is equal to zero. What does it mean? It means that if you have a sound peak of plus, that is a sound peak approaching the boundary, it is reflected, it becomes phi minus, but it's multiplied by r, that is, it's... there is a reflection coefficient, r, which is, it reduces its intensity, okay? So when a peak, when a sound peak approaches the boundary, it is reflected, the right moving sound peak becomes a left moving sound peak, it becomes phi minus, and the ratio between phi plus and phi minus is just r, so it means that the reflection there is a reflection coefficient, and you lose some energy during the. Collision. Okay, here is just to see, just to demonstrate how it goes. You take this system, you give it a kick in the middle. Okay, you generate energy mode which starts spreading, and two sound modes that. One moves to the right, and the other one moves to the left. So that's the picture that you see after some time, okay? Once you give it a kick in the middle. You wait a little bit longer, these peaks reach the boundaries, and they are reflected. You see this right moving, they start generating at the boundary this blue line there and the yellow line there. They are reflected. If you wait a little bit longer, then they disappeared, and all you are having is the reflected sound wave. And if you calculate the area here relative to the area before collision, that would be r. So it's a reflection, but there's a reflection, but you lose the energy. Okay? Yeah. Sorry?
The phi plus r phi
minus. Right.
Does it have a derivation?
Yeah, yeah. Which equation?
The top one.
Sorry?
The top one.
Yeah, that, this was the derivation. Because I want, you see, I want this to be zero and this to be zero. These are the boundary terms. Because I want, you see, these are the boundary conditions. So in the continuum limit, you get. And you express them in terms of this phi. These are the boundary conditions that we derived. Express them in terms of phi plus and phi minus, they will give you this. Just take this equation, okay? Yeah. So. So now we have the boundary conditions, we have everything. R is this. Now, what is this reflection coefficient? Just some comments. Oh, first of all, it's positive. No, it can be positive, can be negative, it doesn't matter. It's when lambda goes to omega, is equal to omega, it becomes zero. This basically means that you have kind of resonance. That is, the chain is coupled to the bath with the same, you know, the relaxation time is the same as the intrinsic frequency of the chain. And therefore, there is no reflection. It's as if just when a sound peak reaches the boundary, it just disappears. It's as if you have infinite system, if you want. On the other hand, if lambda goes to infinity, it's as if R is equal to 1. R is equal to 1. What does it mean, lambda infinity? You remember I said before, lambda infinity means that it dissipates the energy very fast, because the energy is dissipated minus lambda times P at the end. And so basically, the two end particles basically almost do not move. They are static. And it's like fixed boundary conditions. And in between is whatever in between. R could be negative. It means, okay, that's no problem. In fact, in the picture that I showed you, it was negative. Because a negative peak become positive, etc.
So if lambda is infinity, then what happens to these nodes? They dissipate.
No, when lambda is zero. When lambda is equal to omega, they just go out. There's no reflection.
When lambda is infinite.
When lambda is infinite, then they are reflected. With R is equal to 1. They are reflected as is. A phi plus becomes phi minus with the same intensity. You don't lose. Okay. Okay. Now, basically, we are on. Right. That goes into the diffusion coefficient. Into the diffusion coefficient, basically, that's what determines this fluctuating hydrodynamics. That's a diffusion coefficient that enters. Sorry? No, the model independent thing, the model dependent things is the lambda. Is the coupling to the reservoir, and I want to show you how it couples to that. That's not, the D itself is not, as long as it is there, it doesn't matter what it is. So the exercise we have to do is the following. We have the equation for phi plus minus. I give you initial condition and some noise, and I want to solve the equations. Okay, I solve it, and then I want to calculate the energy current, because I say that the energy current, I can express it in terms of the sound modes. Okay, so that's, and once I have the energy current, then I'm done. So these are the equations that we have to solve. And now if you look at it, you see, let's first look at a simple case, either R is equal to zero, and when n goes to infinity. Basically, these are just diffusion constant, diffusive equation with some diffusive equation with some velocity. It has a sound velocity, and the Green's function associated with that, forget the noise, is just Gaussian, right? Just it's a Gaussian with a moving x minus 1 with velocity, which is either sigma is the index of whether it's a right moving, either plus 1 or minus 1, right moving sound wave or left moving sound wave, sound mode, and it's just x minus y plus or minus omega t, and it's a Gaussian and it moves very smoothly. So that's for the simple case. Of zero reflection coefficient and just simple Gaussian. Then the phi, you can solve this equation. Having the Green function, you have to solve the following. Just look at this equation for a minute. It's very simple. You have the Green function times the initial condition. Suppose you have a sound wave with initial condition at time t equal to zero, and basically this is the response, okay? It also has to respond to the fluctuating noise, so you have the Green's function times the noise, and you have to integrate over, because the noise appears at all times, you have to integrate over both y and the time t prime, okay? But that's the solution. Now, what happens when r is not zero, and what is the Green's function? It turns out that the Green's function, you can solve it, because it's just Gaussians, basically. It's a combination of Gaussian. What happens, this is the expression, it's a linear combination of Gaussians. And it's the following. It's very simple, just in words. The equation is not important. You have a Gaussian, which is it reaches the boundary, and then it's reflected with reflection coefficient r, and then it's get to the other side and keep on reflecting. So basically, it's a sum of all these reflected Gaussians. This would be the Green's function, and what you have to basically do is to take this Green function, insert it into this equation, and you have the rather than Gaussian, you have to take the sum of all these Gaussian to get the solution, the phi. Okay, now basically we are done. What we have to calculate is the current, which is phi plus squared minus phi minus squared. That's what we want to calculate. The stationary current is given by this formula, and the kernel is given by the JJ correlation functions. So we can express the J in terms of the phi, right? The JJ correlation function is phi squared, phi plus squared minus phi minus squared, again, times phi plus squared minus phi minus squared. It's a four-point correlation function in the phi. We have the solution of the phi. These are Gaussian, so you can calculate all these averages, and this can be done, okay? I don't want to get into the details, but that's the story. It's a linear equation. The solution is some combination of Gaussians that I showed you before. We have to calculate some four-point correlation functions. You can do it. And this is the end of the story. This is the kernel. And the kernel is basically, it turns out to be 1 over square root of u minus v. That's to your question. It appears here. But then plus sum over n. And then there is r, capital R is little r squared. It's always, okay? It's little r squared. And these are the reflected, basically, expressions. And it's a function both of u minus v. And then depending on how many reflections it made, there is this n. Basically, that's what it counts. And this is the kernel. This is a precise kernel of this problem. By the way, to your question, you ask what happens if I take two different lambdas on two sides. What happens is that instead of having r is equal to r squared, you will have r is equal to r plus times r minus. And r is just, you know, lambda plus on one side and lambda minus on the other side. So it's not a big issue. Okay. Now, and basically we are fully done. I want to calculate the temperature profile. So if I take R is equal to zero, suppose no reflection at all, then as I said before, the kernel is 1 over square root of u minus v, right? That's what the kernel says. Here it is R to some power, so the only one that survives is this. It's a square root. And you can invert the kernel, calculate this, as we said before, and the meniscus exponent is 1/4, okay? This is for zero reflection. Turns out that the problem with fully reflecting, that is fixed boundary condition, was studied by Lepre, Monasterio, Politi some time ago, and they find that nu is equal to 1/2. not a quarter that we found here, but one half. But they took different boundary conditions, that is fixed boundary conditions. It turns out that that's what makes the difference. That is, if you calculate the meniscus exponent depending on the reflection coefficient, it turns out that it is a function of the of R, and it changes from one to the other depending on R. R, remember, is lambda, is this parameter lambda that we talked about before, the way it is coupled to the, okay.
Given that we have explicit form, you won't be able to.
Sorry?
Given that we have explicit form.
Right.
Given your formalism, you'll be able to calculate that.
Calculate what?
Meniscus exponent, you want to fix bound.
Yes, of course, yes.
If you put R equal to 1.
I put R equals to 1. In fact, I give you a formula which relates R to the meniscus exponent, okay? Yeah, you're okay. Without getting really into it, I don't want, it was a little technical at the end. The point is the following. How do you calculate what is the meniscus exponent? I just say it in few words. Suppose the meniscus exponent is nu. So dt dv, v is the rescaled distance near the boundary, it's just v to the minus nu, okay? So it goes with a point nu. You take this meniscus exponent, and you take this dt dv, and you calculate the current. Let's backtrack for a second. This is the current. That's how we have to calculate it, okay? If we know the kernel, we know that J, the stationary current, is a constant, then we want to calculate dt dy, okay? So to get rid of this constant, take a derivative so that it is zero. So dk du times dt dv, that should this integral should be zero, that should determine the dt dv, right? I have to solve this equation. So this has to be zero. Now, if you take this kernel and assume that t goes like that at the boundary, it turns out that if you take only this term, for example, you get that there is a term generated which diverges like that with the u. So it has to be compensated, because this has to be zero, it has to be compensated by some term there. And so you calculate all the terms that contribute to this singularity, demand that it's zero, and it gives you the equation. Eventually the equation, don't forget it, this is the equation, it's that relates R. R appears only here, is some integral which involves the exponent nu, the meniscus exponent. So if you know R, or if you know, you can calculate from this equation, you can calculate the meniscus exponent nu. And of course, for R is equal to 1, you get 1 half. For R is equal to 0, you get 1 quarter. And in between, you get extrapolation from as a function of R, from 0 it is a quarter, for 1 it is a half, and basically that's what you have. So the point is that the temperature, you can calculate the whole temperature profile, of course, not only the this is the temperature profile for some, this is for R is equal to 0, this is for R is equal to a half, but the point is that the important thing that from this thing is that the profile and the exponent depend on the coupling to the bath, on some parameter which is really, just dynamical parameter, which is not does not enter into the heat conduction itself. Okay, that's it. I think I'll stop here. I don't want to talk about Libby flights, and this is a summary. Okay, with that I'll finish. Okay.